When one screen is not enough, get the second one. And when that's not enough, get a bigger one. Hi everybody, I'm Maciek, and I want to show you the FPGA terminal that outputs the VGA signal to the VGA screen. And it's a kind of extension to the calculator that allows displaying various things on the big screen. The way it works is very simple. Here we have the calculator board with the two microcontrollers, and in previous video I showed you that this microcontroller is basically controlling all the calculator, and it's also sending the data via the UART to the FPGA. So how this works? You have to first select the printer select and terminal mode menu and select one of the terminal operating modes. Let's say you want a normal mode, and you can see the data on the screen. First thing to note is that no matter what we do with display modes on these lower displays, it doesn't change the screen on the VGA, and this is because those operating modes of the onboard screens and the external screen are independent. So here we can select any mode that we want to, and let's start inputting some data on the RPN stack. And as you can see, they appear right here because this is basically the RPN stack, 9-level RPN stack. Above it we got the last operation, just like on these little screens. Here is the program counter value for the program. Here is the Tenkey screen. Two Tenkey registers are displayed right here. And as you can see, we got two Tenkey registers, and right here is the memory, is the not the memory screen, it's the statistical screen. So let's add some data into the statistical registers. As you can see, they update. We can also have the alphanumeric data. As you can see here, we have the alphanumeric registers and the program name. If we have a program that's loaded or it's created, we can have its name right here. Then we have the second mode, which is the memory mode. Let's select it. And as you can see on the left side, we have this whole lot of memory cells, and obviously those aren't all the memory cells that calculator has access to, but it shows around 20 memory locations. So let's add something to the memory. Store 10 in memory cell number 1, store 255 in memory cell number 5. As you can see, all this data appear on the left. Let's add 256 to the memory cell number 5. Basically all of these operations are already explained in the previous video. This is the video showing the terminal and the stored program feature. So let's get into the third mode of operation. So the terminal can be also working as a virtual printer, and to do this, select S2, which means serial 2, from the printer selection screen, and I will enable RPN, Tenkey and statistical trace printing. So what we're doing now is that basically all the operations are now printed. And we also have the screen that shows two last prints right here. We can, this is also a new feature that wasn't previously shown. And let's do some operations. As you can see, every operation is traced right here. If we do some operations, they are being shown on the screen. Basically what it does is that terminal is working just like any kind of printer connected to the system. The only difference is that this is in a color, so it can show some data in a color corresponding to the certain function. The blue color is for the Tenkey operations, the white is for the RPN operations, magenta is for some special operations like clearing and so on. We can do the manual printing, which is in a yellow, or we can print something together with the alphanumeric registers, or we can print the alphanumeric registers alone. Now let's demonstrate the stored program feature. And what it does is basically stores the programs on the flash memory chip that's connected via the SPI to the microcontroller. I think that's a W25Q64 memory chip from the motherboard. I have desoldered it from the dead motherboard and put it on this little PCB. And what it does is basically allows you to browse through the programs and load the programs from this memory chip, and it also allows you to store the programs. That's the feature that have been added. So let's make it the printer and let's show the stored program feature. I press right here and I can now scroll through the program list using this encoder. Each program has an alphanumeric name of 16 characters. So let's load some program. Let's load the state of charge program. How you select the program is basically you go to the page you want, and state of charge is the second line on the display. So let's press 2. And it loaded the program. We can see the program name, state of charge, and the program listing here on the right. So let's execute the state of charge program. So I think we have to now input the type of the accumulator, the type of the battery, and it says that we have selected 12 volt car battery. And now it asks us, it went into prompt mode, it asks us to input the open circuit voltage. So let's say the open circuit voltage is 12.6, and let's continue the program. And it's shown us it says 13 volts because it's rounded, and the state of charge 93%. Now let's basically get rid of that rounding. Let's increase the precision and run the program once again. Select the car battery and input open circuit voltage. Let's say it's 12.38. And it says state of charge of 75.9%. You wanna see another program? So let's load another program, internal resistance. So it's the second page, line number 4. So we input 4 and program internal resistance is loaded. So let's maybe increase the display precision. Again, let's switch it to the printer mode and let's store the program. And it asks us for a open circuit voltage. Let's input 12.65, proceed, it prints it, and now it asks us for a for a closed current, closed circuit voltage. So this is under the load. So let's say 12.49 and proceed. It calculated that there is voltage drop of 0.16 volts and it asks us for a load that we put on it in amperes. So let's say we put 11.6 volts, 6 amperes load. And now it printed the data. You can see the open circuit voltage, closed circuit voltage, the voltage drop, current, and then internal resistance in a milliohms. But how to actually store a program? So let's basically input some program that basically adds 12 to whatever's on the stack. Or let's do it that way. And end that program. We have the program, now we have to name the program. So we go into the alpha mode and let's call it UL for useless. To be fast, I don't wanna input all the letters. Just make it fast because I'm running out of the memory on my mobile phone that's recording that. And now we have to press record and the value of the first alphanumeric register is now the name of the program. But how to record it? We have to first find some place using the program load function. And let's say we want to replace that program on the bottom, which is basically a program number 3. As you can see, here are the program numbers from 0 to 3. So it means that this is program 0 and this is program 3. So we input 3 because that's the place when you want to store the program. We place shift and bootload. And now we can select the bootloaders, dumpers, or we can write to the memory. Write to the memory to the location 3. Yes, we want to write. Record to 3. Are you sure? We confirm by pressing that and the program is now stored. And now we can power cycle the device. As you can see, there is no program. And now we're gonna load that program. So you can see the UL and load the program. For we got a program. So the program works. There are also some little things that have been added. We have the backspace function that works for the numbers and for the alphanumeric mode. And we also have the, finally we got the subroutines and conditional jumps, which are the very essential things. And they are finally added. So thank you for watching. I hope you like the calculator. See you later.